Good morning, brothers and sisters. The topic I want to talk about today is how is the bride in Revelation chapter 19 related to the bride and wife of Revelation 21. The Word of God reads, "After these things, I heard a loud voice of a great multitude in heaven saying, Alleluia, salvation and glory and honor and power belong to the Lord our God. For true and righteous are his judgments, because he has judged the great harlot who corrupted the earth with her fornication, and he has avenged on her the blood of his servants shed by her." Again they said, "Alleluia, her smoke rises up forever and ever." And the 24 elders and the four living creatures fell down and worshiped God who sat on the throne, saying, "Amen, Alleluia." Then a voice came from the throne saying, "Praise our God, all you his servants, and those who fear him, both small and great." And I heard, as it were, the voice of a great multitude, as the sound of many waters, and as the sound of mighty thundering, saying, "Alleluia, for the Lord God omnipotent reigns. Let us be glad and rejoice and give him glory, for the marriage of the Lamb has come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her it was granted to be arrayed in fine linen, clean and bright, for the fine linen is the righteous acts of the saints." Then he said to me, "Write, blessed are those who are called to the marriage supper of the Lamb." And he said to me, "These are true sayings of God." And I fell at his feet to worship him. But he said to me, "See that you do not do that. I am your fellow servant and of your brethren who have the testimony of Jesus. Worship God, for the testimony of Jesus is the spirit of prophecy." Now the time had arrived for Christ to marry his bride. I believe the bride is the church, having been previously taken to heaven in the rapture. Eve, having been formed from Adam's body, was organically united with him, Genesis 2. In a similar way, the church, consisting of all those baptized into the body of Christ by the Spirit, 1 Corinthians 12:13, is spiritually joined with Christ in a unique way. She is his church, which he now weds. To better understand the passage in Revelation 21, as it describes the New Jerusalem as a bride, we must understand the Old Testament prophecies about Jerusalem being married to God. The marriage of Israel to Jehovah is seen in promises of God concerning the city Zion. In her restoration, God will rejoice over the city as a bridegroom rejoices over the bride. Isaiah 62 says, "For Zion's sake I will not hold my peace, and for Jerusalem's sake I will not rest. You shall also be a crown of glory in the hand of the Lord, and a royal diadem in the hands of your God. You shall no longer be termed forsaken, nor shall your land any more be termed desolate, but you shall be called Hesbah, which is my delight is in her, and your land Beulah, married, for the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. For as a young man marries a virgin, so shall your sons marry you, and as the bridegroom rejoices over the bride, so shall your God rejoice over you." Ezekiel 16 says, "Thus says the Lord God to Jerusalem, when I passed by you again and looked upon you, indeed your time was the time of love. So I spread my wing over you and covered your nakedness. Yes, I swore an oath to you and entered into a covenant with you, and you became mine, says the Lord." Isaiah 54 says, "Sing, O barren, you who have not born. Break forth into singing and cry aloud, you who have not labored with child. For more are the children of the desolate than the children of the married woman, says the Lord. For your maker is your husband. The Lord of hosts is his name, and your Redeemer is the Holy One of Israel. He is called the God of the whole earth. For the Lord has called you like a woman, forsaken and grieved in spirit, like a youthful wife when you were refused, says your God. For a mere moment I have forsaken you, but with great mercies I will gather you. O you afflicted one, tossed in tempests and not comforted, behold, I will lay your stones with colorful gems, and your foundations with sapphires. I will make your pinnacle of rubies, your gates of crystal, and all your walls of precious stones. Indeed, they shall surely assemble, but not because of me. Whoever assembles against you shall fall for your sake. Isaiah 54, verses 1, 5 through 7, 11 through 12, and 15. It is in this sense that the New Jerusalem is also said to be the Lamb's wife in Revelation 21, verse 2. Although the marriage of the Lamb takes place in heaven prior to the second coming in the millennial kingdom, there is an aspect of the marriage involving the New Jerusalem which extends into the eternal state. This aspect is broader than the initial consummation in Revelation 19 and likely involves the redeemed of all the ages. The relationship of the New Jerusalem as the wife of the Lamb is founded on these Old Testament promises which describe God in a marriage relationship with Jerusalem. In the new heavens and in the new earth, the bride concept will be expanded to include not only the church, but also the redeemed of all ages as the New Jerusalem becomes the bridal city. The New Jerusalem is called the bride because it embraces the bride and because it is the bride's everlasting home and residence. But for the very reason that it is the home and residence of the Lamb's wife, it must include her, her companions, and her attendants who share the glory with her, but who are not strictly the bride herself. When the marriage of the Lamb takes place in Revelation 19, the descent of the New Jerusalem is at least 1,000 years into the future. The city will eventually be presented as a bride, but does not participate in the marriage described. The bride is a figure for a material city yet to come, as well as for the inhabitants of that city. The bride figure cannot be limited to the individuals who will live in the city. It must also include the literal city with her physical characteristics. The New Jerusalem is the bride of the Lamb in the sense of the promised restoration of Jerusalem having found its ultimate fulfillment. Now, going back to the marriage of the Lamb, the bride is granted her wedding garments now and found to be wearing them when she rides forth with Christ at his second coming, Revelation 19, verse 14. This indicates that the wedding itself takes place in heaven prior to the second coming. One further matter of reconciliation requires a separation of the wedding itself, Revelation 19, verse 7, from the wedding feast, Revelation 19, verse 9. It is necessary to have the marriage initiated in heaven after the rapture of the saints, because when Christ's army of saints returns with him to earth, they will have already put on their wedding apparel, Revelation 19, verse 8. So the initiation of the union happens in heaven, but the celebration of that union with a grand wedding feast ensues on the earth. So tying it all together in sequence, in Revelation 19, we see that the marriage to the Lamb happens after the rapture of the church. Then the church is seen with their wedding apparel already on when they return to earth with Christ. The marriage supper, the celebration, takes place on earth. As Jesus said, quote, "And they will come from east and west and from north and south and will recline at the table in the kingdom of God," Luke 13, verse 29. When the thousand-year millennial reign is complete, we read, quote, "Then I saw a new heaven and a new earth, for the first heaven and the first earth passed away, and there was no longer any sea. And I saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he will dwell among them. And they shall be his people, and God himself will be among them. And he will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will no longer be any death, and there will no longer be any mourning, or crying or pain, for the first things have passed away." Revelation 21, verse 1 through 4. So clearly the distinction is made between the redeemed, the bride of Christ, and the New Jerusalem, the city made ready as a bride adorned for her husband. Then one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues came and spoke with me, saying, "Come here, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And he carried me away in the spirit to a great and high mountain, and showed me the holy city, Jerusalem, coming out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Her brilliance was like a very costly stone, as a stone of crystal clear jasper. In conclusion, brothers and sisters, in the meantime, those who accept Jesus are baptized into his body. In the same way that Eve was literally one flesh with Adam, having been taken from his side, so believers are joined into the spiritual body of Christ and betrothed to him. During Jacob's trouble and the great tribulation, the wife of Jehovah is being purified on earth in preparation for her restoration during the millennial kingdom to follow. At the same time, the bride of Christ is in her bridal chamber, having been taken in the rapture and wed to him at the marriage of the Lamb. Later, after the millennial kingdom has come to a close and a new heavens and new earth are created, the holy city, the new Jerusalem, is prepared by Jehovah as a bride adorned for her husband, the Lamb. The long, unfulfilled promises of the restoration of Jerusalem, which found their initial fulfillment in the millennial kingdom, Isaiah 62, will come to final fruition in the new Jerusalem, where all of the redeemed of all ages are in union with God and the Lamb, who are its temple. This is the ultimate consummation of all the redeemed. God bless.